Yes, Sachinji, I think you have touched a very good topic of technology selection. So not only Meda, but we as a solar developers or solar EPC companies have to ensure our checklist should be in place for each and every segment, each and every aspect, including procurement, as well as the installation, as well as commissioning of the projects. So we have seen wind projects wherein huge infrastructure need to be developed. But at the same time, challenge at rooftop solar segment is its customized segments depends upon the roofs and you know, the various profiles and curves. So here, not only module and inverter, but the complete BOS, including cables, structures, proper earthings, and LA connections, and each and every connection of the solar plant comes into picture, wherein we as a developer, as well as EPC, we have to take care of such things. Definitely, yes, once such kind of things will be specialized at site level, because in solar we have seen, as a study, it has been, there was an article that more than 60% of electrical contractors have become solar APC companies now. One thing I would like to remind to each one of that, yes, we are working with solar. Sun is abundant way of energy is available with us. But at the same time, we have to ensure the complete quality aspects of this plant so that it will sustain for next 25 years. The customer who is paying each penny of the plant, we have to ensure that that penny should not be wasted just in the air. So other than the technical and technology selection, I think there is one more debatable topic, which is the insurance of the solar plant. Because we have seen the incidents where there is a shortage of generation, or whatever estimated generation was there, which is not getting fulfilled at the end of the year. And there are a couple of other incidents where the solar plants, because of storm and because of natural calamities, they have thrown away. So this panel, I think, can anybody put light on that?
Well, I think as far as insurance is concerned, all the OPEX consumers or service providers, they are taking insurance of at least fire and burglary, if not the complete IR policies. So that is not a concern as far as the solar is concerned. What I would like MEDA and MSEDCL to also consider is that some of the states, what they have, they understand that solar has the limitation that it is only available during daytime, only 50% of the time. And some of the states are allowing rooftop solar to be available at least 50% of the capacity of the consumer. So suppose a consumer is having a 50 kilowatt connection or contract demand, then at least up to 25 kilowatt he can go. And in future, I feel that storage is going to come in future. In future, if the storage is coming and the consumer is ready to put some percentage of storage into his system, then you should even allow gradually to make it to 75 or 80% or maybe at some time even 100% of the contract demand. So this will allow coexistence of DISCOM as well as the solar industry, that DISCOM is not getting whatever informed power is coming into the grid. It is not getting some sort of problem for the distribution agency, as well as the consumer is having the option of increasing the size of his rooftop solar. Because at present, if you restrict size of the rooftop plant, and if the consumer is having sufficient roof space, he is not able to use his full rooftop potential of his roof. And as you are aware, even from a perspective of generation, solar power generated on roof and used within the complex is the most efficient way of dealing with solar power, that there are no losses. The power which is produced is used in the same place. So it is a win-win for consumer as well as for the DISCOM. So some thoughts for this suggestion, Mr. Sachin?
This aspect can be considered. There are certain technical issues related to this, and much is to be done on that, because the loading capacity of the transformer is to be considered while taking this issue. So previously the limit is at present the limit is because of that issue only, the switchgear and the transformer loading. So that can be considered, and we can have a study on that, and feasibility of the same can be verified.
Precisely as you told, there are many new disruptive technology that is coming. Like solar is, of course, in solar we are trying to see that how much we can offset from the normal DG set. Like for example, our biggest trade deficit in terms of import and export is all through the oil. So when we are fighting with solar, of course with the grid, we are fighting with the DG set to have minimum utilization of the DG. At the same time, there are many disruptive technology like fuel cell, like of course like in Thermax also we have already developed the fuel cell, which is hydrogen is going to be injected in the fuel cell and that is going to generate the electricity. Of course it is at 125 kilowatt kind of very small level, but sooner or later we are going to upgrade to the higher capacity. So there are many disruptive technology which is going to be a tough challenge going ahead. So I think this is nowhere to very challenging at this point of time when we're talking of all these regulations. But bigger things are to, we have to be ready for the challenges in the future. Yeah, thank you.
We had a good discussion on the investment opportunities in the state and the upcoming opportunities of solar and EV also. Now I would like if we have some questions from the audience.
I'm Dr. Dhananjay. Basically, we have a company called Thought Power Corporation, which is out of Pennsylvania, US. And I'm also a professor of at College of Engineering, Pune, mostly focusing on e-mobility. In fact, one of the panelists mentioned about the fuel cell. To the panel, what I'll request, because basically the way the government of India is forecasting about this e-mobility, like 2025, they will have around 5 to 6 million. Of course, earlier target was to achieve it by 2020 itself, which are extended to 2025. And by 2030, they have a plan to go for all these commercial vehicle completely shifting on e-mobility. Now, based on the increasing density of e-mobility, there will be definitely demands for renewable energy, because it only makes sense for going for e-mobility when you have enough source of e-mobility. Now I was wondering that since morning, a lot of panels, like probably the developers, they are selling the power at fairly low price than what ultimately the end users are going to get. Why not? Because these are the kind of models we have implemented in US and few other European country, and that's the kind of trend which is going to happen, that when you are going for such a huge investment for developing the solar farm, of course the next technology which is going to come is trading in battery. And we have done some lot of studies that if you go for selling the power and invest in battery and battery technology, because that's one of the area where we extensively work on, like where the newer battery which is going to have a life of nearly 30 years. So that's a swapping of batteries. So you straight away start selling the power. And there you have a revenue model that you are generating the revenue almost on daily basis, whatever the power you are generating. So there can be many, many other innovative methods, like Thermax guy has mentioned about the fuel cell, where you generate the energy, you convert electrolysis, you generate hydrogen. That can be, because that's another topic, which is hydrogen economy, like basically the entire energy requirement you can run through the hydrogen. So many of these innovative technology which can be disruptions, where you bypass this electricity distributions company, and those are the kind of things required to be explored and implemented. So we want to have some light from the esteemed panel on this topic.
Yeah, thank you, sir, for taking up hydrogen economy. So Hinduja Renewable is, we are presently watching this space. We are seeing that at present this technology is pretty expensive for the country. But we feel that in times to come, once the conversion happens through solar power, ultimately this is going to be economic. And once those scales are reached, economies of scales reach, this can be used as a e-mobility solution for driving at least the big commercial vehicles, buses, heavy load transport. So those kind of e-mobility can be driven through hydrogen economy. So that is one part of the solution. So yes, you are correct that once these kinds of technology become mainstream and they come into the country, then they are going to completely bypass the distribution network, and the solar farm can produce hydrogen cell, fuel cell at the location and transport it to be used at any time of choice. Also, along with hydrogen economy, we are also watching renewable storage solutions, where the storage technology, when it will come economic, such kind of storage will be possible both at utility grid scale as well as at the consumer end, which will be a solution to replace the genset power which is there, because this will be the power on demand that you will be having a set amount of power with you which you can use at any time. And battery management system currently which are there in the market, they have the capability to understand the grid changes, understand your energy requirement, and charge discharge according to the need. So those things are going to come. We are only waiting. Just like the solar cost curves have come down, we are finding that the storage curves are also coming down in the similar way. And very soon we are going to have storage when it hits below $75 or $50 per kilowatt hour. Then probably that is the right time for our country to go mainstream into that. So this is going to come.
Yeah. I'm DG Meda. I would like Sachin Agarwal, then Colonel Kumbhoj, and Suvendu Lenka. You have put up some suggestions. I would like a mail on that, preferably today or tomorrow, by tomorrow, so that whatever possible I can incorporate it in policies. Thank you.
I think I also would like to, sir has told to send the mails, because recently MEDA had conducted one meeting with all the developers wherein we from various segments, IPP as well as developer side, OEM side, we have given them all the inputs. And thank you, sir. I think one more initiative MEDA has recently taken, that recently there was a session along with Niti Aayog and Prayas Energy, wherein, as sir, you rightly said, this is a transition phase towards e-mobility, and huge infrastructure need to be developed in terms of not only the actual mobility and the manufacturing of setup, but here the infrastructure network for electrical. So they have already conducted the study on that. And vision 2050, towards 2050, whatever modifications, retrofittings, and green infrastructure need to be developed according to that, they are working on that. So the one is policy framework, and other one is its commercial aspect. Once it will fit into commercial aspect, definitely the day is not long that everyone will use e-vehicle. Any other say on this? Thank you.
Thank you so much. Any other questions?
Hello. Hi, everyone. This is Vikas Dukhande from Asmi Energy.
We are the EPC company, so my question straight to the Sachin sir. Everybody is talking about grid supporting charges. There is another charges for captive consumption as well. There is almost 600 rupees per kW for HT consumer for a captive consumption. Why it is when I am using as an end user, if I am using, I am developing, there is a system which developed for my captive consumption, why should I pay that much amount to the MSEDCL?
Exact, that is 645, to be more precise. Again, earlier I just quoted that we have proposed, and after all the deliberations and taking consideration into the, because the system, our MSEDC or the reference is utilized. So if something can be shared, then it will definitely benefit the other class of category. See, we are not going to make profit out of all this thing. It is to be passed on to the consumer in all the categories. So after considering all these aspects and making a balance, I think we will get something, whatever is...
Sir, as an end user, my payback will goes to 7 to 8 years.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. But I'm not opposing that investment. But if the investment due to this is increasing for 1 or 2 years or 3 years, I think you are also serving the society, and some sort of share should be taken, because just another Mr. Sachin told that he has shown our balance sheet. Of course, I'm not challenging that and making any comment on that, but every balance sheet is having asset and liability. So we have huge liability being the utility. You can understand our issues also. There are bad debts also. There are issues for recoveries also, which we are resolving. Secondly, as per the loss is concerned, we cannot compare our loss with the NDPL, BYPL, BRPL. I'm saying about this Tata and Reliance in the... Because they are having different consumer mix. We are huge, 45 lakhs agriculture consumer we are serving. I don't think any state is serving for 45 lakhs of agriculture consumer. Of course, we are trying to reduce the cross-subsidy surcharge. Now we are insisting solar pump. So in future, the cross-subsidy should not increase. We are working on that. Now we are releasing only solar pumps for agriculture pump. Agriculture consumer. So in future we are trying to that the cross subsidy amount should not increase, but for that we have already, I think, around 1 lakh solar pump orders has already been issued. I think everyone is must be knowing. This is the one step ahead to reduce the burdens which we are getting, and of course that is just to share the burden of society. Okay, thank you.
It shouldn't be that much high, sir.
Just one input from my end. We want MSEDCL to survive, because everyone sitting here, we are taking the services of MSEDCL. MSEDCL is acting for solar producers as a big battery storage. In some way or the other, definitely we are using MSEDCL. But there are other ways of generating revenue. Since you had pointed about Delhi, I will just give you some more figures for other states. Telangana AT&C losses at 10.15%. Kerala is at 9.99%. Himachal Pradesh 0.74%, which is the best in the world. Delhi, anyway, I mentioned it is at 8%. So 18%, if you are able to bring it down to by 1%, that is at 17%. You will be able to increase your profitability by 50%. Right now you are at 1,000 crores. You will directly jump to 1,500 crores.
we take it in
so Sachin again it reiterates that SolarWinds is going more of a finance side rather than on the technology.
And other things, since I have handled those books. 1 year of profit doesn't make set off of 12,000 regulatory assets sitting already. So the accumulated losses over the years are so much. Now that profit is really aberration. It came through true up and some charges were allowed to be recovered. But by and large, the equity entitlement that MSEDCL has, it doesn't recover a fraction of it. That's the truth. So MSEDCL is not really taking away any profits.
We'll close the session and we'll break for lunch. Thank you, panelists, for your valuable time and insights. I would request everybody to just hang on for 2 minutes, if possible. Just 2 minutes, and then we can head for the lunch. I know I'm also really hungry. I know. So now, just a small thing. Now, I request Mr. Pankaj from Ganeshkin Urban O&M Circle, MSEDCL, to kindly do the honor and distribute memento among our respected panelists one time. It's going to take 2 minutes, yes. Ladies and gentlemen, a little more energy and the clapping has to be there. I also request Mr. Sachin to give the memento to Mr. Pankaj after this. Sorry. Yes, can I please request Mr. Sachin to give the memento to Mr. Pankaj? Thank you, sir.